Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm excited. I am really excited. For those of you that this is your first time, my name is Pastor Stephen, and I get to serve as part of this incredible group of people as your pastor. So, where to begin? Why am I excited? Want to know why I'm excited? Because I'm losing my voice. I am excited because we're meeting in here instead of over there. I'm excited because there were a lot of people that were fighting this week against sickness. I'm excited because we're under attack. That sounds strange, doesn't it? Doesn't sound strange to you to be excited when I'm under attack?
A little bit.
For someone who doesn't know God like we know God, that's really unusual. But when I'm under attack, it means that someone doesn't like what I'm doing. God is on our side. We're on his side. And there is an enemy who wants to come to kill, steal, and destroy. So when he's coming against me, it means I'm probably doing what I'm supposed to be doing. So what's really going on? Why are we meeting over here? That's what everyone really wants to know, right? Okay, so it was discovered that the ceiling in the sanctuary was coming down a little bit at a time. We noticed some cracks. We got the insurance people out. We've got structural engineers out. And as a safety precaution, while we don't anticipate it collapsing on anyone, but as a safety precaution, we're meeting over here, getting scaffolding up, and it could be a very big deal. So this is not just a one-week thing. We don't have a lot of information of how long it will be, but it could be a number of weeks or a number of months. And we can pray that God fixes it, or we can pray, God, thank you for giving us a whole new roof. And with some patience and endurance and going through some times of trials and tight spaces, God can bring us out with something even better than we can possibly imagine, okay? So what that means for over here, we had about a week to work out all the stuff and sound and screens and trying to get stuff online. We didn't get it all done, but I'm not worried. And you shouldn't be worried either. But I am so grateful for the incredible team of volunteers that we had this week that came up to set up the sound, to set up screens. That came out when they weren't well or volunteered to come out to put screen slides in and stuff. I'm blown away by the servant heart of the people in this church. So the goal is for us to get the screen next room over working, and we're creating space for more and more people. We've got close to 100 seats in this room, 40 in there, and that's more seats than we've been using in the other room anyway. And once we grow past that, should we still be out here and we're still growing, feel free to bring your fold-out lawn chairs and you can sit on the other side of the window there and we'll just put a Bluetooth speaker out there. You can have church outside or inside at the same time. Whatever you like. God's not prevented from reaching through a window, right? So I'm excited. I am not worried. But is it not like God? I mean, I know God has a sense of humor, but he also has a plan. That he decides to bring this crazy new pastor in and start preaching about construction ahead before we realized that we had to have construction above our head. I mean, if I didn't feel led to go in that direction, I didn't know, I promise you, I did not know about that. And I didn't go climb up there and jump up and down to try and make it come down and say, I'm a prophet. No, I didn't do that. But it's because of that, that when I start seeing things like that, God clearly is in control here, folks. So when you start seeing things like that, don't worry. Don't need to stress about it. I mean, God's been preparing me and Charity for stuff like this for years. I mean, we used to set up church in less than 5 hours. Yes, we woke up at about 4 o'clock in the morning to go and unload a truck into a massive auditorium for adult services and children's services with a team. For 5 hours, we would set up everything and a lot more. We had 5 days to work this out. This was a piece of cake. So, and when things don't work out, you know what? Getting the screen working or not working, that's not the church. Connection with people, that's the church. So I'm going to take you on a bit of a journey today, because the title for my message is not where I intended for it to go. But God took me on a little bit of a journey this week, so I'm going to ask you to stay with me. The title of the message is kind of my last point, and how I'm going to get there is not the way I thought I would get there. The title of the sermon is, If Your Walls Could Talk. If your walls could talk, what would they say? Originally, I started out thinking I was going to talk about bridges, that we're going to talk about building bridges, because we've been talking about building lots of things, building roads, building walls, building the temple, building a roof. Building bridges is where I started with this, and some of the songs today talking about the chasm, which is in between us. Some of you may have heard the bridge illustration for salvation, that on one side is where we are at, and then there's the great divide, and God is on the other side. And the thing that separates us is our sin, and that we can't get across it until Christ came in as our mediator and bridged the gap. He paid the sacrifice, and the only way for us to get from one side to the other is through Christ. He is the only way. He is the only sacrifice that bridges that gap. Luke 16:26. And besides all this, between us and you, a great chasm has been set in place, so that those who want to go from here to you cannot, nor can anyone cross over from there to us. So the illustration is that Jesus is the bridge. We're supposed to be like Jesus. So he wants us to be little bridge builders. We want to help bring people to the cross. A lot of us are in a world that's fully divided. We're divided by culture, we're divided by age, we're divided by race, we're divided by belief, we're divided by politics. There's too much division that we allow to separate us when God has called us to be like him, bridge builders. What are we doing to connect with people that don't look like us, don't think like us, don't smell like us? We're supposed to be bridge builders, even if we're perfumers. Remember last week, we talked about how even the people who made perfume were called to build a part of the wall around Israel when Nehemiah rebuilt the wall. Regardless of what you do as an occupation, you're called also to be a bridge builder, to help bring people to the bridge, which is Christ. Isaiah 58:12. Those from among you will rebuild the ancient ruins. Now this church is not ancient, but it's older than some of you here. It's younger than some of you here. Rebuild the ancient ruins. You will raise up the age-old foundations, and you will be called the repairer of the breach, or the gap, the chasm, the restorer of the streets in which to dwell. You're called to be peacemakers, not dividers. If you're causing division, you're doing the opposite of what you're supposed to be doing, which is causing multiplication. Come on, that's good stuff, church. Luke 14:23. Then the master told his servant, go out to the roads and country lanes and compel them to come in so that my house will be full. You know, I believe in a full church, and there's scripture there to back it up. I believe in a growing church. It's not about the numbers, but it's a full church. This is not a full church. Just like Charity said, if you think that list is full, it's not full. Create space. We can fill up the overflow room. We can fill the other seats. We're not full, and God wants us to be a full church. It says, compel them to come. We are supposed to be about his business. Even when Jesus was just 13, he says, I must be about my Father's business. Had an interesting conversation with a group that was here at prayer the other day about whether Christ was actually just a general builder rather than just a carpenter, because there wasn't a whole lot of trees. There was some trees that they imported, but they're more likely was a stone worker or just a general builder. So when he's saying, I must be about my Father's business, yeah, he's talking about God being a builder, but he was also trained in just general building and not just carpentry. So we're supposed to be like him. We're supposed to be a builder. Not necessarily buildings, but building relationships. We're supposed to rebuild, supposed to repair, to restore, rejuvenate, or recharge. But all of those things are simply bringing something back to what it once was. I believe that God wants to do more for you than just fix you. He wants to give you an upgrade. He wants to make you better than what you were before. He wants to do a transformation. He wants to reform you or remodel you to make you into something new. If you don't believe me, just look at 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old things have passed away and all things have become new. He wants to transform you. He doesn't just want to put you back together so you work, so you function. I can repair things with duct tape. God wants to do something more permanent. He wants to give you an upgrade. He doesn't. While he can fix our roof, I think he wants to do more than that. He wants to do more than that. He wants to give us more space. He wants to give us an issue so we don't have to worry about our issues with our internet going out and spreading the gospel around the world. He wants to fix our so much for us. And this is an opportunity, because we were thinking, you know what? It would be kind of nice and kind of cool to have some lights, but I don't really feel like climbing through the attic space, which is only this big. How are we going to do it? I don't know. God shakes up the foundation a little bit. We get some cracks in the roof and the insurance pays for it. Thank you, God, for our new roof. But the process required a little bit of shaking. The process required a little bit of discomfort. Did God send a tornado and the snowstorms? He certainly knows how to use them for the benefit of those who love him. There's a process. 2 Corinthians, we just read that one. So God can restore things that have been lost. He can restore money. He can restore property. He can restore your broken down car. He can restore your house. He can restore your relationships, but one thing that's a little bit harder to get back is time. It's harder to get back your time. But even time, once it's gone, you can't jump in a time machine and go back. But Joel 2, 25 through 26 says this about getting back your time. So I will restore to you the years, which is time, that the swarming locust has eaten, the crawling locust, the consuming locust, and the chewing locust, my great army which I sent among you. He sent the locust. He's the one that did that. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be put to shame. God has the ability to make you more productive with 1 year than you were with four. In your relationships, in your time that you've spent. He is capable of working that out for you. So often if you work and you don't see a reward, you're like, man, I did all that for nothing. All the crops have been totally destroyed. Entire 4 years of crops gone to waste. What did I do that for? We say, how, God? How can you restore to me something that is dead? How can you restore a relationship of a lost loved one? How can you restore my physical ability? Stephen, you don't understand. I'm old. I can't do those things anymore. My mental ability is not able to do those things anymore. But the way God can do it is he can still increase the quality of your relationship with him to where you start realizing that your physical and your mental capabilities are actually a really small part of you compared to the spirit. That we're so focused on this short part of our existence. If I had a rope and it went all the way around this room like 3 or 4 times, this little end piece here, this is your time on earth. And we're so focused at the beginning this, oh, I need to save so that this time here at the end, this will be a good high quality life right here. Yeah, I'll be able to retire and have lots of money. I'm going to have a good life here. I'll be able to vacation here. But this, I have to work hard right here. And so the people that are living like that have a hard time understanding when people like us who are here are thinking about not investing in this, but investing in this. Investing in that. Investing in the kingdom of heaven. Investing in helping other people get there instead of worrying about investing in this. Be kingdom-minded. Your spiritual man and the quality of your relationships with God is far more important than your physical abilities. So when God restores, he's able to restore with a greater quality and quantity. Sometimes he'll do both. But the Bible tells us that whatever the enemy has stolen from you, he can give back 120%. He actually can do a lot more, but 120 specifically, we can find in Leviticus. This is a really cool one. You ready for this? You ready? You get anything out of this yet? 120%. Leviticus 6, 4 through 5. Then it shall be, because he has sinned and is guilty, that he shall restore what he has stolen, or the thing which he has extorted, or which was delivered to him for safekeeping, or the lost thing which he found, or all that about which he has sworn falsely, he shall restore it full value, add 1/5 more to it. So that's 120%. And give it to whomever it belongs on the day of his trespass offering. So have you ever felt like something was stolen from you? Maybe physically something was stolen from your driveway, from your home. Maybe you feel like the devil stole your health. Maybe he stole something from you. He stole your business. Maybe you felt like you've been extorted. Something was swindled out of you. Maybe you gave something to someone to hold on to and you trusted it, and then they decided to keep it. Maybe you just lost something and you couldn't find it anymore. This saying here, that could be returned to you plus another fifth, another 20%. Oh, Stephen, that's just old covenant stuff. That doesn't apply to us. Oh, it doesn't. Well, doesn't it say in Hebrews 8, 6 that we're under a better covenant with even better promises? Amen. So if he does 120% under the old covenant, then hey, I believe in for more. God's able to do more, exceedingly, abundantly more than you could ever ask or think. Oh, but wait, there's more. Say that. Oh, wait, there's more. Are you excited? You know, it's like QVC coming on here. The trespass offering that it spoke of. You know that Jesus is our trespass offering? The way it worked is that if someone sinned, they would have to find a perfect lamb and bring it to the priest. The priest would check out not your sin, he would check out the quality of the lamb. And we have a pure, spotless lamb. Your sin, almost irrelevant as long as the lamb was pure enough. But he inspected that first. And the lamb was punished in your place. Jesus took the debt that you owe. So the enemy stole from you. He meant it for evil, but he's got a way of turning it for good. How much more good, Stephen? Oh, much more. God is not just in the restoration business. He's in the much more restoration business. If he had a business called restoration, it would be the much more restoration business. Oh, but wait, there's more. It's time for an upgrade. When's the last time you upgraded your phone? Who's got the fanciest phones out here? You don't have to raise your hand. You don't need to brag. What is it? We'll be up to iPhone 12, 13, 20? I don't know. Hey. All I know is that most people that have iPhones have cracked iPhones. Right? Give me my cheap phone that doesn't break when I drop it. That's good for me. It's definitely good for charity. It's time for an upgrade. You know, that season comes around every year. The new one's out. I gotta have the newest one, the greatest one. But why is it we don't take that upgrade? It's a free upgrade. Nah, Stephen, nothing's free. Nothing's free. I know there's a contract involved. What if something better comes out later? Let me tell you something. If God offers you an upgrade, there ain't nothing better coming out later. You got a problem with committing to Him? Salvation is free. Yes, it is, but it's going to cost you your whole life. Read the fine print. Large print giveth, the fine print taketh away. It's true. Always read the fine print. Salvation is free. Yes, it is. Exodus 22:1. I like this one. You ready for this? If a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it. We're going to do a big barbecue out here real soon. I'm just telling you. It's a sweet smelling incense to the Lord, barbecued meat. It's biblical. Anyway, if a man steals an ox or a sheep and slaughters it or sells it and he has a big barbecue, he shall restore 5 oxen for an ox and 4 sheep for a sheep. Did you catch that? You get 5 oxen for an ox, but only 4 sheep if they stole a sheep. Which one's bigger? The ox or the sheep? The ox. The greater the loss, the greater the restoration. So when I see we're under attack and we're losing our voice, we feel like surgeon says, I need to take that body part out. We're losing our roof. We're losing our mind. We're losing our peace. We're losing our relationships. We're losing our marriage. We're losing our kids. The greater the loss, the greater the restoration. Amen. I'm excited when I see that the enemy's trying to steal something from me. Take the roof. Take the whole building. Because that means that God can give me even more. That's why I'm not worried. Because He can't outsteal what He can give. So if you're under attack, fear not. Rest in Him. Your supply and restoration is coming. But wait, there's more. God wants to give you a double portion. Oh, there's lots on double portion in the scriptures. You ready? Stick with me. I'm going to fire off 3 for you. Isaiah 61:7. Instead of your shame, you will receive a double portion instead of grace. Instead of disgrace. Just making sure you're following along. You will rejoice in your inheritance. And so you will inherit a double portion in your land. And everlasting joy will be yours. Just real quickly. Joy has nothing to do with your circumstances. God wants you to have joy. He's not trying to make you happy. He's not trying to make you happy. He's trying to give you joy. A lot of people say, do whatever makes you happy. That's right. If it makes you happy, it must be right. If it makes you happy, it must be good. Just because it feels good doesn't mean it is good. Happiness comes from an old English word called happenstance, which is the same word that we get circumstance. I happen to have a good day. I'm happy. Woohoo! But you can have joy even when things are not going right, because the joy that the Lord gives is the thing that gives you strength. Walls can be tumbling around. It can collapse. As long as it don't collapse on somebody, I'm all right, you know? But the Bible says He can turn our mourning into dancing. And when I was a kid, I thought that meant when I wake up out of bed, I can start dancing. That's not what that means. It's not that type of mourning. It's like sadness mourning. The type of mourning you have when something has died. A family member has died. A loved one has left you and says, I'm disowning you. I'm never talking to you again. That type of grieving, mourning, sorrow, he can turn that into dancing. How? I don't know. Until you experience it, the logic of it doesn't make sense, but it's something that happens in your spirit that he can do it. God does more. He upgrades. Job 42:10. The Lord also restored the fortune of Job when he prayed for his friends. And the Lord increased double all that Job had lost. Zechariah 9:12. Return to the stronghold, you prisoners of hope. Any prisoners of hope here? That's a good thing to be a prisoner of hope. He's the one that brings hope. That's the thing that I'm held captive by. Hold on. Hope is an anchor for our soul, is what the Bible tells us. So when the wind comes and the storm comes and tries to blow you around, the thing that holds you firm in the midst of a storm is hope. So to be a prisoner of hope is a good thing. Even today I declare that I will restore double to you. See, the difference between renovation, repair, is that to renovate is to kind of make it look new, but a repair is to help it improve from the damages. But he wants to remodel. He wants to go above and beyond. But wait, there's more. God does more. He upgrades. 1 John 3:1-2. I'm on this journey. I'm gonna get to how the walls speak in just a little bit. You still with me?
Okay.
Nudge your neighbor. Say, you still awake? 1 John 3:1-2. Behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God. And it's not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. So he's calling us his children. He's calling us his sons and daughters. So he's actually taking some extra legal responsibility over you. Once he's saying, I'm going to adopt you. I'm going to make you my children. I don't just have rights over you, but I'm going to make myself committed to you. When he adopts us, it's proof that he wants you. He's chosen you. I didn't get to choose my children. I'm thankful for them, but it's not like I could go to the dog pound and go, yeah, that one's cute, that one's cute. This one, he's kind of funny looking. He should be fun. Go ahead, send him home with me. I didn't get to pick my children, but God chose you. Being an adopted child, I mean, I don't know what it's like to be an adopted child, but just that feeling that they want me. He wants me. He wants you. He chose you. And not only did he choose you, but he then promoted you to the level of joint heir with Christ. It wasn't uncommon in Bible times that if there was a wealthy man who had no children, he would adopt a young slave who he would then trade his slavery for sonship and pass on that inheritance to someone who was once a slave but had been granted sonship. Talk about an upgrade in your life. You were once a slave to sin. God gave you an upgrade and you were a servant to the Lord. And then he gave you another upgrade. Oh, wait, there's more. Now you're a son to the king. Some translations will use the word child of God. Some translations will use child of God. But often the original language, it will say son of God. And that's not with the intent of excluding the women and the girls. It's saying that once we're in the kingdom, that the girls will get the same reward as if they were the firstborn son. So when you're looking at the translation, it says child, ask yourself, you know, there's a lot more power when you say son, as long as you understand that that's not excluding the women. It's saying that the reward is even greater for a firstborn son in the context of what they had, because back then the women didn't get anything. You might have been the firstborn daughter, but you're not even mentioned some of the times. But the Bible's telling you that you are going to get the same reward as if you were the firstborn son, adopted, joint heir. Whew. Come on, somebody. I'll be getting something out of this. Yeah, that's right. Thank you, Zoe. Romans 8, 15 through 17. The spirit you received does not make you slaves, so that you live in fear again. Rather, the spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his suffering, in order that we may also share in his glory. Squeezing into this little space, that's not suffering. We're going to have a little bit of discomfort over here, sure, but this is not suffering. It's really not. God is so good. He has provided people in this church with the skills and a heart to serve to fix the air conditioning in this room last week without them even knowing that we were going to be meeting in here this week. God's timing and his provision is absolutely incredible. That before we ever knew we were going to meet in here, when it came to designing this room, someone decided to put soundproofing on the ceiling. Did it not sound fantastic to worship and hear your brothers and sisters next to you this morning? That was God's providence long before we ever knew it. It's an amazing thing. So, there's a transformation process that we have to go through when we get this upgrade in life. So bridge builders, restoration, upgrade, process to upgrade. The process to upgrading something is a change of perspective, a change of your mindset, and a change in your language. Our perspective used to be a slave to desires, and now we're a child of God. Mindset used to have bad feelings, and now we have peace. The language, we used to speak hopeless language, and now we see opportunity. The perspective is an upgrade. The perspective is that there are obstructions that are in the way. The issues that we know that are going on in the roof over there, in the rafters, you cannot see them until you remove part of the ceiling. There are cracks in your structure that you cannot see because they are hidden. There's cracks in your covering that you are not aware of because they are covered by some drywall. A lot of the times, has anyone ever bought a house that you shouldn't have and you discovered all the mistakes afterwards and you saw that someone basically just did a lipstick job but they didn't really actually fix what was underneath? I know Jay's probably come across that a few times. Sometimes we're hiding the real issues and we know how to play church. We know how to make it look like we're a good Christian. But we're actually afraid when someone starts talking about construction. Like, what might they find? Ooh, I don't want people to know what I'm really like underneath. We're afraid of what might come out, which leads us to, what if your walls could talk? If someone went to your home and your walls started telling them what you've been doing when no one else is around? What if your walls could talk? We have to renew our mindset. Oh no, Stephen, the roof's going to come down? That sounds like it's going to be a lot of work. Oh no, it's going to take a long time. Oh no, the contractors are all going to be booked up and we're not going to get in there until next year sometime. I'm not worried. So you can either look at those facts and be worried, or you can say, this is going to be great. Once it's done, we're going to have more space. We're going to have greater influence. We're going to have a much better atmosphere. This is going to be great. We get to get closer to one another. We get to learn how to use an overflow room better. We get to learn how to do church outside better. We get to learn, speaking of which, in case I didn't say this already, if you want to bring your chairs and just do church outside and look through the window, you can do that. We've got lots of space. We'll just put a speaker out there. Maybe I'll preach out there and you can be in here. We start changing our language. When we see bad things happen very quickly, we go, why did God let this happen? Why did God let this happen to me? I'm a tither. I'm a giver. I go to church every Sunday. I raised up my children the way they should go. Why are they doing this to me, God? We start having these attitudes, these thoughts, man, this new pastor gets here and the roof's come down. He must be cursed. He had us walk around the church one time. We should have done seven times. And now look what happened. You've got to change that and go, God's going to give us an upgrade. This is a good thing. This is a blessing. God is going to use this to make it better. God is not surprised by this. God is in control. Romans 8:28. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him. Do you love him?
Yes.
Do you really love him?
Yes.
Anyone love him enough to shout it out? I love you, God.
I love you, God.
I think I'm finally getting somewhere. Just in time for me to try and wrap this up. So here's some reflections, some thoughts. I read this article about things you discover during renovations. Totally not a biblical article, but I love how God does something in the physical as a representation of things that are taking place in the spiritual. So I didn't put everything I read in here because I'm like, I can't think of any spiritual connection or parallel, but these are some good ones. What does God want me to learn here with this so I can get to there? Because often we don't get there because we didn't learn what we were supposed to here. What will happen? What do you think is going to happen when we start praying, God, search my heart? What do you think he's going to find? Here's some dangerous prayers. When you start praying, God, or what do you think? If God grants the devil that he might sift you like wheat. The devil asked God, can I sift Peter, the disciple, like wheat? Can I sift you like wheat? And he said, yeah. And Jesus said that to Peter, and Peter's like, I'm never going to leave you. I'm never going to fall aside. You know the process of sifting wheat? They put all the grain in the top, and they shake it up, and most of it falls through, and you're left with what's left over. What if we started praying, God, sift our church like wheat? Dangerous prayers. It's a dangerous prayer. It's kind of like when you're looking for gold. You put all the stuff in the top. Hey, we got a big church. We got lots of stuff in here. And you start panning for gold and you find there's the real ones. It's a dangerous prayer. But Gideon had an army of 22,000. And he says, if you're afraid, you can go home. And those that are left over, he says, go drink some water. And those that drunk it like dogs, he says, you guys can go too. He's left with 300 men. I would take 300 faithful followers over 22,000. I would take 30 faithful followers in this church over 200. That's a dangerous prayer. It's a dangerous thing to say. Stephen, you can't do that. Where are all the tithers and the givers going to go? You ever hear the Pareto principle? 20% of the people do 80% of the work. So, and 80% of the people create 100% of the work. God's going to shake you. He's going to squeeze you. He's going to make you hot and uncomfortable so that things can be revealed. Things are going to be stripped off of you so that what's on the inside can be seen. When you squeeze an orange, what comes out? Apple juice? Ooh. Orange juice. When you squeeze a grape, what comes out? Pineapple juice? When you get squeezed, what's supposed to come out? Jesus juice. You get squeezed, Jesus juice comes out. For things to be, things have to be revealed. You can't fix what you don't know is broken. If you don't know that it's broken, you can't fix it. And the only way you can know that it's broken, it has to be revealed. Anything that is hidden will come to light. But God doesn't just want to fix the symptoms, he wants to fix the cause. Some of us like to keep the causes hidden. We don't want people to know about our dirty laundry basket. We don't want them to know who we really are, and we're living in denial. The first step of any recovery group is admit that you've got a problem. If you don't admit that you've got a problem, no one can fix you. You can't fix you is the second part. You have to realize that you're not capable of fixing it yourself. You need him to fix you. You have to, one of the people that came by and they looked in above, they're like, they didn't know whether it was safe or not. It's like, you need to know what's right and what's wrong, what's safe and what's not safe. If you don't look in, you won't even know. God wants to address the causes for your structural failures. But he wants to make you stronger. The only way that you build muscle is by breaking your muscles. Anyone ever go working out, get muscle fatigue, and the muscles actually tear? But when they heal stronger and they heal bigger. The only way for us to grow is to go through some muscle tears. We're afraid of what might get found out when someone starts peeling down our walls. Don't be surprised what you'll find if your walls could talk. So here's this article anyway. God allows shaking in your life. It will reveal the shortcuts that you've taken. Talking with Sam about some of the stuff when this place was built and finding like one plug is on one fuse and then there's like 20 on a different fuse. Like, do these guys know what they were doing? Or maybe there was a good reason for it, but sometimes from the outside looking in, it just seems like someone took a shortcut. What shortcuts did you take in your life that when your life starts getting shaken will become revealed? What foundations are you missing? Missing foundation footings is what it said. This restoration business that wrote this article says, occasionally they'd find missing foundation footings. People that are coming to church know how to make it look good. They've got a nice little structure, but they didn't actually start building with the foundation. So they know how to sing, they know how to pray, or at least make it look like praying, but they don't have the foundation, which is that relationship with their Savior. Shortcuts, where someone focused more on the beauty over its purpose. It looks good, but they realized that the house was actually being held up by the siding and the drywall, and once they removed that, the whole thing collapsed. When we were taking down some of the wood beam up in the middle to try and make it safe for them, make it so they could put the scaffolding up there, we were just joking around saying, as I unscrew this, is this screw holding the whole thing up? And the beam that was down the middle in there was just decorative, you know? What have you been doing to make yourself look prettier on the outside and the inside? Insect troubles is another thing that people come across. Infestations and parasites. What does that mean? How can I talk about infestation and parasites in the church? Are you taking more than you're giving? Well, hopefully we don't have parasites in the church, but once you start shaking the foundation, if they're there, it'll be revealed. Are you taking more than you're giving? Hidden rooms and hidden secrets. I love watching the stuff where like, lady in a house for 100 years, does renovations, finds hidden room sort of articles, you know, the clickbait ones that you never find out what they really found. Like, I just really wish I knew. Like, the hidden room is hidden under 20 clicks of advertisements. But, you know, discovering hidden rooms. So, what hidden rooms do you have that when you say, God, come into my life, come into my heart, and if your heart was a house, do you have hidden rooms in your heart where there's certain parts you say, God, you can't go in that room. You can renovate everything, but that's my junk room. You can't go in there. That's where I keep my dirty laundry. That's where I keep my skeletons. That's another thing, human remains. What dead bodies would be uncovered in your life? What I mean by that is, who have you crucified? What relationships have you killed because of the way you treated someone that would be discovered if all was revealed? As we rebuild, as we remodel, as we move forward to the next season, what happens if those dead bodies come to life and start coming back to this church? How are you going to respond? Past people that have hurt us, past people that we have hurt them, if they come back, how are we going to welcome them? Hopefully it will be with God's love, because we are bridge builders. I skipped past this one, but Luke 12, 2 and 3. But there is nothing covered that will not be revealed, and hidden that will not be known. Accordingly, whatever you have said in the dark will be heard in the light, and whatever you have whispered in the inner rooms will be proclaimed from the housetops. Live lighting fixtures, electrical work that used to be done. World War II, it would be very often that the wires would not be properly coated or covered, and there would be like brass light fixtures. So it's very common in these older buildings that people would go and they would electrocute themselves touching the brass. Now, the issue with this is not that the fixture is old. The issue is that the fixture is not grounded correctly. Just because you're old, I'm not trying to throw you out. Not the issue. You're welcome. I want to make sure that's clear. You are super important, because it even talks about how the foundations of old would be raised, to be elevated, to be, you know, you're important. But it's important that you're grounded. There are some experienced people who are not grounded in the word and in the kingdom the correct way, that have a habit of electrocuting people who don't know how to handle them correctly and are unaware that they don't have the correct coverings on their their life, you know? Just be careful. Some things need to be grounded in the word. Outdated code. Code, when you're building stuff, changes every now and again. Things have to be done a certain way. You have to use a certain type of wire in certain type of places. It's a safety regulation. And that's not because the code changed. It's just we discovered the way they were doing it wasn't actually as safe as they thought it was, and perhaps they misinterpreted the laws of nature incorrectly when they built it. Like, that wasn't a good idea. They were doing it that way. It used to be a code and used to be good enough, but it really wasn't. What do I mean by this? The way that some people used to read the Bible and understand the Bible, we're not reinterpreting it different now. It's just that they never interpreted it right in the first place. Okay? The Bible always meant what it means. What do I mean by this? There's an outdated code. It's a Pharisaic religious rules. Legalism that exists in our church today. When I say our church, the church as a whole exists. I hope to think that we don't have it in this church. But once you start shaking stuff, that's when things start coming out. Legalism. What is legalism? It's that which says that if you don't do X, Y, and Z, then you're not truly saved. If you are a woman and you cut your hair, you you wear makeup, you wear a skirt that's not the right length, and you work outside of the home, then you must not be a real Christian. Or if you're a man and you don't cut your hair is too long, and you do work inside the home instead of outside the home, and you don't spank your kids, and you don't run your household the way you're supposed to, then you're not a real Christian either. If you don't meet X, Y, and Z, then you're not really saved. And we start distancing ourselves from people that don't match our expectations. We start distancing ourselves from people that have some dust. We start distancing ourselves from people because they've got a speck of wood in their eye. Meanwhile, we've got a plank attached to our head. If you listen to certain types of music, you're not a real Christian. If you eat or drink certain types of food, you must not really be saved. If you associate yourself with preachers who are outside of the church, which you consider unclean, then they're not saved. If you just associate with them. Well, if that's the case, then coming to church, we're all in trouble because we've all sinned. We've all fallen short of the kingdom. We're all sinners. So in that case, we're kind of all hopeless, the fact that we step into the church surrounded by imperfect people. So, outdated codes, human remains, live fixtures, insect troubles, shortcuts. We're supposed to be building his kingdom. His grace saves us. His spirit changes us. Our job is to help bring people to the bridge and introduce them to the King. Let them know that he loves them. It's not our job to fix them and make them feel like you have to be worthy before you can come to him. Come to him and let him clean them. Let him change them. Let him talk to them about what they should or shouldn't eat, drink, sleep, do. I'm going to love you. I promise you I'm going to disagree with you, but you have a right to be wrong. And I could agree with you, but then we'd both be wrong. But just because we don't, just because we don't agree or see eye to eye on everything or even interpret the scripture the same way, that doesn't stop me from loving you and caring for you and doing stuff for you, expecting nothing in return. That's real love. We're going to finish up this service with some communion, which I think is a great way for us to reflect on what it means to be bridge builders, what it means to be part of the body of Christ, because the bread is the body of Christ, and we're also the body of Christ. So as we take it, do it in remembrance of him, but do it in remembrance of parts of the body that you've not been connected to. Maybe you got hurts with, and we need to be reconnected. But there's parts of the body that should be here that aren't here for whatever reason. So I hope you've stuck with me with my meandering thoughts that started with building a bridge to realizing that if I'm going to be doing some building, some of my own mess is going to become more apparent. Let me pray, and then Jay's going to come and do communion, and if anyone at keys or sound, that'd be great too. Don't know if we've got a song at the end. But. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for your word. I want to thank you that you have a plan and that the attacks of the enemy on our life, Lord, they're just signs that you want to do something even better for us, that you have a better promise and a better covenant, and that you're the one that gives me strength and gives me breath in my lungs and a voice to speak, even though the enemy's trying to take it away. He cannot steal it, because you're going to give a greater power, greater strength in our families, in this church, in our marriages, in this church, Father. The things where there is a divide, I know that you are the great mediator and you can bring things together. You can bring people together. You can help us love the way that you love us. That you brought us, you chose us, and took us from being a slave to sin to being an heir. Thank you for that upgrade, Father. We thank you for the plans you have for us that we don't understand and we don't see. The plans you have for this church, for the lost, and for those to come to know you. And we get to be part of that. We thank you for it in Jesus' name.